And I didn't think the government could stoop any lower. As lore is getting more and more heavy, there are so many things in this chapter that are very well worthy of talking about that I don't even think a better reviewer has even mentioned every single one, and that's the problem with me here, the Anger and the Fan, the Despair reviewer, who will technically only review one chapter, so something like that. What I mean is the fact that so much is happening in this chapter that some people have pointed out and something have not pointed out. What am I trying to say? Well, this is the One Piece chapter of 1060, and first off, the cover page is not the detailed cover art. It is actually an updated cover of a very long time ago when there was only 4 Straw Hats. Now it's all 10. It almost looks exactly the same, except not different, with the new additions, of course. That is kind of nice. In this chapter, Luffy finally finds out what Sabo did, and unlike Dragon, he for one actually do not believe for a second that Sabo is the one who killed Cobra. And Robin is actually agreeing with him because, well, technically she spent some time with the revolutionaries, so she should know how they work, although I'm still a bit surprised that regardless of the reason, Dragon would not forgive Sabo if he really killed Cobra. But she does say something very interesting, is the fact that the revolutionary are after the world nobles, not the kings. And, I mean, that is true. Koala did say that they wanted to overthrow the world nobles, but there are many corrupted kings around the world. Surely they intend to dethrone them. Either way, the article says about the Sabo's declaration of war on Celestial Dragon, the king of Alabasta, Cobra, being assassinated, and Vivi mysteriously disappearing. And of course the Straw Hats are very worried about that, especially of the fact that they're going... Luffy wants to go to Alabasta, but Zoro being the apathetic voice of reason, as usual, is pointing out that all of Luffy's insecurities here are not gonna help the matter. Of the fact that King Cobra is already dead, not to mention they are halfway across the world, how are they gonna get to Alabasta? And then Luffy suggests to go to Marijua. The biggest surprise of it all is the fact that Zoro protests against that. I'm saying surprised because this is a guy that wants to become the world's strongest swordsman, and you're telling me he is chickening out about fighting the entire forces? Granted, just because he wants to be the strongest swordsman doesn't mean he is he is a fool. But I mean, he was even unsure of facing off against all the beast pirates because it was going to be drained. And since it is the headquarters of Navy headquarters, well, that means the strongest of the strongest are there. So yeah, even someone like him would be very drained. Also, unfortunately, it's revealed that Karoto is still not here. Uda, can't you just go out and admit that you hated her? Because, I mean, the conclusion of her character is no conclusion at all. Couldn't you have at least sent us a flashback of something that really shows that she thanked the Straw Hats for riding with her? But no! Instead, you just give her this title of Duke, and that's it. No conclusion with the Straw Hats. And yet you give it to the Yamato, the character who's an even... No, sorry. A character who's a worse character. A character that's truly bad. Karoto was great. But now you are playing favorites just and giving this a middle finger because suddenly you didn't think Karoto would become that famous, huh? Because of Furio and all that stuff. Unsatisfactory. Truly unsatisfactory. No conclusion to the Karoto storyline. Because it's revealed that in the barrel there is none other than Karibo, and the barrel is chained up. Probably implying that they knew he was there, so they chained the barrel up. Karibo is such an annoyance. And of course they are all worried about that. The newcomers who have not met Vivi are a bit wondering though. So Zoro is the one who really put them all down again by saying that Vivi has her own adventures, similar to how Luffy said about Ace. And while Luffy agrees a bit about that, they say they should vent. And it's pretty funny though that when all of the four Straw Hats that were on Alabasta. It's worth noting though that Usopp is not in this scene, which is kind of too bad. It's the fact that they call out Zoro on his heartlessness, like you're an ogre for Onigashima, Green Kaido, Green Mom, Crappy Marshead. And it's only when Sanji calls him Marshead that Zoro fires back by shut up, fourth place, which of course resulted in them fighting. And then Robin reveals the other reveal, of course, the desolation of the Shichibukai system, the formation of a cross guild, and Buggy becoming emperor. And it's worth noting that when Robin talks about Buggy becoming emperor, it's only then that Luffy speaks up and says, "Now that's just a mistake." Agreed, Luffy. It's a complete and utter mistake. We as the readers know that it is a genuine mistake. It's just that it's pretty funny that someone as idiotic as Luffy actually agrees that it's so idiotic that someone like Buggy would become an emperor. And of course there are other important information there, but Luffy says that, well, you just tell me if it's important. He believes that Sabo didn't do it. After all, Sabo's dream is for everyone to be free because he was being controlled in his youth. It was during that time he remembered when he was shouting out with the dream in the cliff. At that time we thought he meant being the Pirate King. But as we learn of date, becoming Pirate King is not the real end goal of Luffy's dream. No, he has another dream. A dream that can result to him only if he is the Pirate King. And of course, in typical Oda fashion, we do not hear it. But the Straw Hats do. And the reactions, well, the reactions are mixed. The genuine surprised, to teared-eyed laughter, to Chopper being amazed. And once again, some clues are being dropped here. Clues have been saying that it has to be something. Usopp, the more normal person, is saying that is not possible. Who thinks something like that? This probably implies that there is something unrealistic, something that a normal person or maybe a cynic really wouldn't believe. But Luffy believes he can do it if he becomes Pirate King. But the fact that Robin's reaction is pretty interesting, because she actually looks a bit silent and asks playfully, "Who else did you tell this?" And Luffy says that he actually has told Shanks, who also laughed with tears in his eyes, which probably implies that he heard his captain say the same thing, and he was either nostalgic or he was very impressed. And that's the end of his dream. And of course, by saying it's the end of his dream, most people laugh with tears in his eyes, including Jinbei. The one who is most impressed and doesn't even question this is Chopper. And as we all know, Chopper is the youngest child of the group, which probably implies that this is something completely innocent, something a child would think of. And given the fact that Luffy's mentality is sometimes just like a child, and the fact that he even came up with this as a child and has been hanging on to it stubbornly, that implies there is something innocence in this dream. Something a lot of grown-up wouldn't think because, well, it's just so childish in their symbolism. And what else is there in the clue of it all? They agree that it does sound like Luffy to do this. And everyone else laughed and was amazed. There is one final clue in this, but we do not know what that is, so to speak. However, they're on their way to find the last Poneglyph. They just don't know yet. But then we get to the more shocking part of this chapter. The Gorosei gets to hear that Sabo is actually the Lulucia kingdom, and their reaction are actually, well, not shock, but it's more like, oh, I see, as we see Eam as well. And they call Sabo an unlucky man. It turns out that Lulucia kingdom was one of those kingdoms that had an invasion, that rebelled. The revolutionaries are happy to hear that Sabo is alive. We also see some revolutionary in the background. It was one who pointed out that one revolutionary surprisingly has dark wings, but I don't think we should look too much into it. That revolutionary is very hard to see. Most of all, in the background, that person do not have dark skin. So no, I do not think that is a Lunarian. I think it is just an aesthetic. But it's actually revealed in this talk that Sabo, another reason why Sabo is running away, and also another thing that why Sabo has an eclipsed white Denden Mushi, it is actually, in the biggest shock of all, he actually saw Eam. He saw Eam sitting on the empty throne. No wonder he got framed for killing King Cobra, because it does reveal very quickly here that no, he did not kill Cobra. And that's a relief, but it's also something we knew. The Gorosei definitely killed him. But the biggest question is, did they kill him because he asked too much? Or did they kill him because Sabo saw Eam and decided to get rid of Cobra and frame Sabo at the same time to throw off suspicions even more? I mean, I genuinely believe they intended to kill Cobra all along. But they must have decided that once Sabo somehow saw Eam, they must have decided that framing Sabo for King Cobra's death is the best way to make him, well, go on the run, everyone after him, and everything else. But it's clear that they did not intend on all this rebellion. Although it's worth noting that the bald-faced Gorosei talked about the Great Cleansing, and the Great Cleansing starts this chapter. So it's very likely that all of this revolution that has been happening, that's another excuse for them to do this, because we see something. We also see the King Seki and his spoiled daughter. It turns out they've been imprisoned, and of course, just like typical corrupt royals, they threaten their citizens with death. But before Sabo can reveal the truth, he reveals the truth in the Denden Mushi, but we do not actually hear if he actually gets to hear that, if Code Dragon gets to hear that, because the communication gets cut off for the Marines, as a voice, likely the Gorosei, suddenly, ominously, not to mention corruptly, tells the Marines, communication, listen to me. You did not detect anything. You did not intercept anything. The Kingdom of Lucia, that country, never existed in the first place. As suddenly a dark cloud swirls over Lucia, and 16 beams of lightning lasers fires down on the island, destroying it and erasing it from history. The Great Cleansing has begun. The government... Oh, the sheer hypocrisy of the government is so funny sometimes that it's horrifying. Or maybe it's more probably to call them so corrupted sometimes that it is funny. Because, I mean, this is the ultimate... what is the word I'm looking for here? Irony? They wanted to dismiss the ancient weapons, saying the destruction and everything. And yet this weapon here is on par, or even is, an ancient weapon. Because the biggest question here is this Uranus? That was what a lot of people, me included, guessed when we saw this. But there was one reviewer who actually brought up a very interesting point. And that was, could this be the Holy Land's Mauritius treasure? And I actually found that intriguing, because yes, Don Flamingo said he knew about an ancient treasure, or a national treasure, that if it was revealed to the public of the world, would shake it to the core. And this is destruction. destruction made incarnate, something that is so unstoppable and something that is so dangerous that, yeah, if this was revealed to the public, they would be in fear, not to mention uproar. Because again, this is also the biggest irony of all. The government bans the ancient weapons and wants to, quote unquote, destroy them. And yet they have in their hands a weapon that can erase an island from existence. And this is also very likely how God Valley disappeared. Another one who pointed out, as I said before, was that someone counted the lasers or lightnings, whatever it was, and actually said that this looked very similar, and they were 16 of them. 16 holy bullets the world novels tends to fire, as well as Don Flamingo's Godofredo attack. 16. Is that Oda just being coincidental as usual? Or is that a theme? Is it possible that the world novels fire 16 bullets because that is an homage to this weapon? Maybe. So the biggest question is this Uranus, or is there a weapon that is on pair of Uranus? Because I believe that the ancient weapons were not created to become, well, weapons. I believe they were created to somehow stop the world novels or everything else. Another one pointed out that this almost looks very similar to Death Pia of Enel. And we all know that Sky Pia is an arc that a lot of people feel pretty much, I mean, it was had no point to it. But maybe it did. Maybe it did have hidden lore to it. Did Enel somehow knew about Uranus and based the arc Maxime on it? Too many questions. But maybe. And finally, the chapter ends with the fact that they now are in a winter island of unknown place where they actually meet a warm eddy that Sanji detects a lady is inside his, both things. Zoro cut it open, misses the lady, but then the strong wind when Chopper with an Onimagashia gets blown away, and Luffy, in typical Luffy fashion, also gets blown away. And who else is on inside a warm eddy? Well, none other than one of my least favorite supernovas. None other than Julie Bonnie herself, now a bounty of 320 million. Pretty ironic, huh? We haven't even seen Drake's increase in bounty, and yet we saw Bonnie's. So yeah, that's basically what this very long chapter says. The sheer hypocrisy of the government is laughable, because it's... this is very worse of it all. So, was Lelouchia Kingdom targeted because Sabo was there, or was this their plan all along? I think that was the plan all along. They intended to erase Lelouchia Kingdom. And it's very likely they intend to erase the other countries that rebelled as well. The bigger question now is, why are they unleashing this weapon now? I mean, if you think about it, if a weapon like that could be unleashed, surely someone would start to question what is happening. And while the Gorosei, the Im, and the world nobles wants to keep this world under their thumbs, it's very clear, though, that they do not want to, well, at least not yet, want a complete dictatorship. They want to create the illusionary of control. They want to believe the people are free, just as long as they control all the angles. They don't want a complete ownership, well, they say, that you have to listen to everything we say. I mean, yes, they want that, but they want that in a way that people do not realize. They want a controlled nation of manipulation, not complete dominicity. It's a bit surprising, though, that why they want that. I mean, so surely someone as them would want to dominate everything. But it's very likely they have realized that manipulating people, it's much more profitable or much more easier than complete subjugation, because also if people united completely against them, and surely even they would have trouble facing them off. So yeah, manipulating them and stuff like that is much better than destruction. So why now? Well, the Great Cleansing was about to happen, but it's very likely that with the reveal of the pirates and Shibukai system, they will do this as a distraction, seeing that if someone starts to question what happened to that island and vice versa, then surely no one will start to question on how it disappeared. They will only blame it on the pirates, because after all, they are hunting pirates with power of vast destruction. So surely all the pirates will get the blame, and maybe even the revolutionaries. So now, which other countries are gonna be targeted? Well, we don't know what the other rebel countries are. But I have a feeling Alabasta is going to be targeted soon. So yeah. Whatever this weapon is, it is something that needs to be stopped. Give me your thoughts if you have any.